Hi everyone, today we'll be doing another chapter, that is metals and non-metals. We all have learnt about metals, we all see them in our surroundings every day, and we also consume and see non-metals. Right? This is basics of chemistry. You will see these elements everywhere. Alright, elements. Elements can be later classified into metals and non-metals. Alright, so metals. We all know shiny substances, we all consume, we all see metals, they are hard, they are shiny. We all see non-metals as well. The air is comprised of non-metals. It is not metal, it is gas, alright? So yeah, let's get into it. Now, what are metals, what are non-metals? There's a basic difference between metals and non-metals, alright? Metals are elements that generally have a shiny appearance, alright? A shiny appearance. What do I mean by shiny? They reflect light, okay? They have a shine, alright? They conduct heat and electricity. Metals will allow heat and electricity to pass through them. For example, supposedly there is iron, alright, iron as a metal, it can get hot to a very high temperature, it can also conduct electricity, it can allow electricity to pass through it, alright. Now, malleable and ductile. What is malleable? Malleable means we can take a hammer, and beat this metal into thin sheets, alright, thin sheets, okay. So this property of metals, not everything can be beaten into thin sheets, alright. This property of malleability, alright, always remember the spelling M-A-L-L-E-A-B-L-E, malleability. Now we come to ductile. What is ductile? Ductile means that I can take a metal and I can mold it into thin sheets. I can make thin wires, alright, thin wires out of metals, thin wires. For example, supposedly we have an electric wire and it is made of copper. Alright, it is made of copper. So, copper has this property that it can be wound up into thin wires, alright, thin wires which can conduct electricity, which can conduct heat, alright. And metals, this is an important property, metals tend to lose electrons to form positive ions, alright. If you see a metal, supposedly M, it will always have a positive ion, alright. What do I mean by this? It can lose electrons, alright. Everything is comprised of electrons, alright. Metals have excess, more of electrons, so it can give electrons and make a bond with another element. Okay, we'll get into it later on. So metals tend to lose electrons to form positive ions. Why this plus? Because it will lose electrons to form a positive ion. Okay, non-metals on the other hand are elements that are generally dull in appearance. All right generally dull. What do I mean by generally dull? They do not shine. They lack shining. Alright, they are blunt. They are not like metals. Alright, we've all seen steel. We've all seen steel glasses at our homes. They are shiny. We all see taps. Taps. They shine. Alright, so non-metals don't shine. Hence non-metals. Dull in appearance, poor conductors of heat. Alright, non-metals generally do not conduct a lot of heat. Alright, they won't get hot so easily. Okay, electricity. Non-metals generally do not allow electricity to pass through them. But one thing you should always remember in chemistry is exceptions. What do I mean by exceptions? I have stated a property, poor conductors of heat. Will all non-metals have poor conductor or act as poor conductors of heat? No. Alright, there will be some exceptions. One or two elements will be an exception. Similarly for electricity, most non-metals will not conduct electricity, but there will be one or two which will be able to conduct electricity. Like for example, carbon is a non-metal, alright. There is a compound of carbon called graphite, it is able to conduct electricity. Sometimes. Now we come to brittle. What do I mean by brittle? Alright. They are not that hard, alright. Brittle and tend to gain or share electrons to form negative ions. Now, in case of non-metals, they will take electrons. Supposedly, I represent non-metals by Nm. There will be a negative sign on the top. Why? It is in a dearth of electrons, alright? Dearth. What do I mean by dearth? They lack electrons. They need more electrons to form bonds, to form a compound. Okay, so they gain or they share. All right, sometimes you have to take, sometimes you share some electrons, give and take. So that is how you form negative ions. Always remember, non-metals negative ion, metals positive ion. Okay, now we go into the physical properties. Just see this table. All right, here will be some exceptions as well. Okay, so now let's get into it. Physical property, what the conducting of electricity. Alright, metals will conduct electricity, all metals will, alright. Now, non-metals, all non-metals will not conduct electricity. For exception, there is graphite, like I told you. Graphite can conduct electricity, it is a compound of carbon. Not everything made of carbon will conduct electricity, only graphite, okay. Conductor of heat. Metals conduct heat? Yes, they conduct heat. There's an exception? Yes, there's an exception of graphite. So for electricity and heat, always remember graphite. Malleable, can be beaten into different shape with a hammer. What do they mean by different shape? Sheets, or with, for any shape, you can take a hammer, beat the metal and it will take that shape, alright. Non-metals, they're generally brittle, they break easily. Okay, brittle, break. They are not that hard, they will break, alright. So, no, they are brittle, they can break easily, alright. Metals do not break easily. Try breaking iron, it will take a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of energy. Ductile can be drawn into wires, like I told you. Metals can be drawn into wires easily. Non-metals cannot. Why? They are brittle. They will break. If you try to stretch them into a wire, they will break, of course. Lustrous. Has a shiny surface when polished. So, as I mentioned, shiny, they have used another word for it, lustrous. Having luster. Alright, luster means shine. When you take a shoe polish and you polish your shoes before going to school. Alright, that has shine to it. Okay, so that is lustrous. Has a shiny surface when polished. Okay, metals have, when you polish metals, alright. So like stainless steel, when steel is polished, alright. It is very shiny, it will reflect light. Non-metals are very dull. They will not shine. They lack that shining property. All non-metals, alright, all non-metals. For example, oxygen, is oxygen shining? No. Is carbon shining? Is your pencil, the lead, is it shining? No. Alright. So, you might say yes, but as compared to metals, no. Okay, they are very dull. Sonorous, okay. What do I mean by sonorous? Sonorous means that it will make a sound. A tongue sound, a vibration sound, alright. So, like, when I hit a steel glass, okay, or when I hit iron, like with a stick, okay, a rod, there will be a ringing sound, ting, ting sound coming, okay, it is sonorous, it makes a ringing sound when hit with a hard object, okay, so yes, non-metals, they do not make that sound, they are dull, okay, they make a dull sound, they will not make a ting sound. When you ring a bell, bell is made of metals, okay, that is why it is ringing. If it was made of non-metals, it won't be ringing, it does not have that property of being sonorous, okay. Now we come to metals, non-metals, the uses of metals. All right, this is an important part. They can ask you in a multiple choice question, for this purpose, which of this metal are used? All right, so we have to remember the uses of each and every metal. Okay, iron and steel, not each and every metal, but mostly used metals. All right, so iron and steel, iron and steel is used in construction, manufacturing, transportation. Have you seen those iron rods that are used to make a building? Okay, it is used to make a building. These are iron rods which hold the structure. Why is it used? Iron has a property of being very strong. It is used in bridges. To make bridges. Now, bridges have to be very strong, otherwise anyone going through it will break. Okay, it will break and everyone will fall down. So iron is a very strong metal. It's a very hard, almost hard to break. All right, very hard to break. It is made from a lot of heat, energy, pressure. Okay, so iron and steel as well. If you see steel is very heavy. Steel is used in manufacturing. All right, so many factories use steel. There are steel factories, they produce steel. Steel is used by many industries for making a lot of things. All right, glasses, machinery, everything is used steel. All right, so and transportation, bridges, like I told you. Okay, even ships can be made of iron. It is used in transportation. Okay, now we come to aluminium. Aluminium is used in aircraft. Why aircraft? Aluminium is light. Okay, not as heavy as iron. All right, so it is light, very light. It's not that heavy as iron. It is used in packaging. We all take tiffins to our school. Okay, so aluminium foil. Aluminium foil. Why? It is very light. That is also metal. It is a very light metal. It can be made into sheets. Foil is sheets. Lightweight and can be used to package. Okay, if you put something hot in it will stay hot. All right, and electrical wiring. So copper and aluminium both are used for electrical wiring. All right, both can be used. Copper is used in electrical wiring. One of the major things used in electrical wiring is copper. Okay, we do not use aluminium that much because it is kind of expensive. Copper is not that expensive. Copper is used in electrical wiring everywhere. Plumbing, we see pipes made of copper. Okay, electronics, if you open your CPU, okay, you will see semiconductors, that motherboard. All right, that also has some part of copper. Why? Because it is easier to transport electricity, to let electricity flow through copper. All right, copper is also used for pots. Okay, copper pots in earlier days. All right, during our grandparents' days, they used to have copper matkas. All right, and all, in which they used to store water. Okay, and they used to drink that. Why? Because it used to stay hot, stay cold. All right, it was considered very beneficial for the health because copper has also some properties that is beneficial to the health. All right, copper ions in the water will be beneficial for you. Okay, so this used to happen in earlier times. Gold and silver. All right, gold, we all know gold is very precious. It is very expensive. Even silver is pretty expensive. Why? Because they are rare metals. Why are they rare? They do not react with any other compound, anything else in the environment. Okay, so gold you will find in its pure state. All right, so It would not have reacted with oxygen, carbon, or anything. You will find it does not react. Since earlier times, since it's a rare metal, it is also used as currency, jewelry, because it has a lot of shine. It is malleable, it is ductile, so we can make very attractive jewelry. All right. From gold, silver. So yeah. Now zinc. What is zinc? Zinc is a metal that is used in galvanizing iron to prevent corrosion. All right. So zinc is used in galvanizing. What do I mean by galvanizing? Electroplating. Electroplating iron. Iron has a property of getting rusted. All right. You've seen many a times. We will come to it. Iron will tend to get rusted. Right, how does it get rusted? It comes in contact with water plus air, which has oxygen O2. Okay, water is H2O, hydrogen and oxygen. Air is O2 mostly. And when it reacts with iron, it gets oxidized. The term is oxidized, but you can say rusted. Okay. It will lose its shine, it will lose its property, it will become weak, it will wear off, it will break off. So to prevent that, what we do is we use electroplating. All right. If you remember electroplating, we take one metal which we want to be put as an electroplating material. So like if here was iron, here was zinc. I want zinc to be transferred as a coating over iron, so I will take a salt solution, okay, having iron, having zinc. All right, so I will take ZnSO4 having zinc. Zinc will go into the solution, it will get deposited over here. There is electricity flowing as well. All right, so this is positive terminal, this is negative. Electroplating I have discussed in detail. So we do this electroplating. It is called galvanizing when it is done by zinc, all right, and iron. So combining zinc on iron is galvanizing. Okay, it's an important term, galvanize, to prevent corrosion, to prevent rusting. Okay, corrosion in case of iron is called rusting. Okay. Now, uses of non-metals. How do I use non-metals? Carbon is used in making fuels, graphite and diamond. Okay. Diamond, it's the hardest substance found on the earth. Carbon is used in making fuels, petrol, coal, charcoal. Your gas at your home, wood, it is all carbon. We use it to get energy, all right, to get heat, to get fire, all right. Now, graphite. What is graphite? Graphite is also an allotrope or a form of carbon. It is used as stone or lead in your pencils. If you see your pencils, they have graphite, all right. We can write with it. Graphite solutions are used to lubricate. As oils for machinery, it can conduct electricity. It is an exception. All right. Oxygen. Oxygen is essential for respiration and combustion. Okay. We are consuming oxygen. Oxygen is necessary for survival of all species on Earth. Okay. Nitrogen. Now, nitrogen is something that is abundant. It is a lot in our atmosphere. Even in the ground, nitrogen is omnipresent. Nitrogen is important as it is used in fertilizers. If there are no fertilizers, the crop will not be good. We will not get food to eat. So nitrogen is an important thing. It also acts as an inert gas in packaging. What do I mean by inert gas? Inert means non-reactive. Okay. Have you seen Lay's? Have you seen your chips packets? They are filled with not air, they are filled with nitrogen, so that the food inside stays out of damage, oxidization of germs, does not go stale, okay, so that it does not go stale, so that it stays fresh, alright, so that is why we use nitrogen. Chlorine is used in disinfectants. The water that comes to our houses is disinfected using chlorine, alright. Chlorine kills all the germs, chlorine kills all bacteria that is present inside the water, and then it is sent to our houses, alright. Chlorine is also in the swimming pools, okay, and it is also used in water purification. Hydrogen. What is hydrogen? Hydrogen is used in production of ammonia and as a fuel. Hydrogen is H2, okay, it burns, it gives out heat, and it gives out, since it will burn, it will be burning in the presence of oxygen. Everything burns in the presence of oxygen, that is called combustion, okay. It will form water, H2O, okay, 2H2O. I will get into the reactions in detail. Remember the remember the signs, the symbols of each element. Okay, carbon is C, oxygen is O2, nitrogen is N2, chlorine is Cl, okay, Cl, hydrogen is H2. Okay, now what is corrosion? Like I told you, corrosion is the process of gradual destruction. Gradual means with time, of metals. All metals can go corrosion, okay, due to their reaction with substances in the environment. Okay, since metals are left open in the environment, it will go corrosion. The agents in the environments, air, water, whatnot, will corrode this metal. It will spoil that metal. So okay, so due to the reaction with substances in the environment such as oxygen and moisture, it leads to formation of metal oxides or other compounds. If you remember, I told you it is oxidation, okay. This metal is oxidizing. Corrosion. Oxidizing is corrosion. For example, iron corrodes to form iron oxide, rust. So this is rusting. What is happening? Iron is getting oxidized. If iron is oxidized, it is forming iron oxide. See over here, this is a machinery. It is all rusted. All rusted. Now, once it is rusted, what will happen? It will not work properly. It has become weak. It is not that shiny, it is not that slippery, it becomes rough, won't work, so we have to throw it away, yeah. And over here you see this pipe, this is undergoing rust. If we get a cut from a rust, okay, something rusting and we get a cut, we get a tetanus shot, okay. If we don't get that shot, we might get that area paralyzed or we get tetanus, okay. So tetanus shot is also important. How can we prevent this corrosion? Applying a protective coating on the metal surface. All right, you apply a protective coating on the metal surface. Supposedly this was the pipe, okay, this was the pipe, okay. Now I don't want this to get rusted. Alright, so I will put a thin layer as coating over this pipe. What will happen will, air, water will come over this coating, but it will not go inside and harm the metal. Okay, so I can use paint, I can use oil, I can use many other things on the metal surface. This is a surface phenomenon. Okay, I can try galvanizing, like I told you, coating the metal with a layer of zinc to act as a sacrificial anode. What do I mean by sacrificial anode? That zinc will get oxidized, but I don't want the iron inside to get oxidized. Okay. Here you can see galvanization. This is a normal bucket made of steel or iron. Once it is galvanized, it will look like this. It has a coating of zinc over it. It is shining more. It will not get rusted. See, this is rusting. This will not get rusted. Using corrosion-resistant metals or alloys such as stainless steel. All right, stainless steel is alloy. Alloy. What do I mean by alloy? It is a mixture of solids. Okay, we will get into it in the detail. Mixture of solids, mixture of metals. All right, it is a mixture of metals. Now, these metal like iron and cobalt, iron and carbon form stainless steel. Okay. Alloys tend to get oxidized or corroded very slowly, very, very slowly. If you go to the Qutub Minar in Delhi and you see the Sanchi Stupa, it is made of metal. All right. That long iron pillar. All right. If you go and see that iron pillar, you will see it is not rusting, but it is, they say it is iron. All right. It is made of alloys. It is made of alloys. Alloys get corroded, rusted slowly. Imagine it has been here for so many hundreds of years and it is not fully corroded, not fully rusted. Why? Because it is made of an alloy. A lot of alloys, a lot of things go into it. That is why it is not getting corroded. Corrosion. Keeping the metal dry or using desiccant to absorb moisture. Okay. So what happens is you need moisture for corrosion. Okay. For corrosion to happen, you need air and moisture. O2 and H2. Oxygen and water. Okay. O2 and H2O. Okay, so if we keep it dry, okay, then it is just in contact with air, normal air, no moisture. Moisture, no. If you keep the metal dry, it will stay corrosion free. You can also use materials that absorb moisture, like powders and all, so that the metal stays out of moisture and it does not get corroded. Cathodic protection. What do I mean by cathodic protection? Connecting the metal to a more active metal to prevent corrosion. Okay, this is what happens in galvanizing as well. Okay, we connect the metal to a more reactive metal. All right, what do I mean by more reactive? I will come to a reactivity series which will tell you which metal is the most reactive, which one is the least. Okay. So alloys, what is an alloy? Alloy is a mixture of two or more metals or a metal with a non-metal. All right. Alloys are created to improve the properties of metal such as strength, hardness, or resistance to corrosion, like I told you. But alloys also increase the strength. It will make it harder, stronger. All right. Stainless steel is strong. Why? Because it is an alloy. Here are some alloys. Okay, copper and zinc. We can make an alloy of copper and zinc. Okay, now brass. See this. This is brass. We use brass, which is copper and zinc, to make some utensils, some bartan at homes and all. Okay, bronze. Earlier, they used to have currency that was made of bronze. All right. Even in ancient times in India, bronze was used as currency sometimes. Okay. Bronze was considered precious. They used to make utensils and things and whatnot and decorations. Decor made of bronze. Remember the composition. Brass is copper and zinc. Bronze is copper and tin. Stainless steel is iron, chromium, and nickel. All right, iron, chromium, and nickel. Now we come to a reactivity series. All right, in a reactivity series, remember the symbols. Remember the order. Remember the extreme points. Now, what is a reactivity series? A reactivity series is a list of metals arranged in the order of their decreasing reactivity. All right, their decreasing reactivity with water or acids. How do we say this one is most reactive? How do we say this one is least reactive? If we consider a metal and it reacts very fast with water or acids, it is considered reactive. If we give water or acid to the metal and nothing happens, then it is least reactive. It helps to predict the displacement reactions between metals and their compounds. We will come to displacement reaction. What is displacement reaction? Like in electrolysis or in electroplating, in the salt solution, some metals that are more reactive, they displace, okay? They change positions with less reactive. All right, so let's get into it. Potassium is the most reactive metal. Its symbol is K. Then we come sodium, Na. Then we come to calcium. Then we come to magnesium. Then we come to aluminium. Now comes carbon, zinc. See, carbon is more reactive. It is a non-metal, yet we have put it here because carbon is more reactive than zinc, iron, tin, and lead. Okay, it is more reactive than these metals. Always remember. Remember the symbols as well. Now we come to hydrogen. Hydrogen is also a metal. Okay. Now it is more reactive than copper, silver, gold, and platinum. So you can see copper, silver, gold, and platinum. Silver, gold, platinum, you know that they are rare, precious metals. Copper as well. These metals, they are least reactive. They do not go reaction. Okay. Remember the signs. Remember the symbols. Okay. Remember the symbols. And this is the order. Now we come to important chemical properties of metals. What are the important chemical properties of metals? Metals tend to lose electrons to form positive ions. Like I told you, metals tend to lose electrons. Metal has excess electrons. Electrons are charged, like I told you. Metals undergo various reactions when added to different compounds. Alright, if we treat them with other compounds, alright, other compounds, solutions and all, they go various reactions. Now we come to what type of reactions and which reactions. Metals react with oxygen to form metal oxides. Alright, it forms metals oxide. These are basic in nature. If you remember acidic basic, what are basic oxides? Alright, basic oxides turn red litmus blue. Red to blue. Remember, B for basic, B for blue. It gets blue, red to blue. Alright, metal oxides are always basic, always basic. What is basic? Your soap is basic. Alright, it is not non-acidic. Alright, alkaline. Another term that you could use is alkaline. Alright, so here are some sort of reactions that metals undergo with oxygen to form metal oxides. Alright, when they form metal oxides, these all will be basic. Okay, these all will be basic in nature. So, for example, sodium, when it reacts with oxygen, O2, okay, it reacts to form Na. This 2 is over here, Na2O. Okay, Na2O. What happened was, how did this reaction carry about? 4Na plus O2 gives 2Na2O. Now, just forget this for a minute. Supposedly, I was just adding NaO2 and I formed Na2O. Like I told you, metals tend to lose electrons to form positive ions. So this one was like this. This was like this. Okay. So oxygen reacted with sodium to form Na2O. And this was considered 2. Now this is 2. This is 4. Now we ba this is called balancing. This is called a balancing equation. B balancing the equation. So again, if I write to you NaO2, Na2O, remember the compound, it formed this. I see there are two oxygen here, only one oxygen over here. So I multiply this whole compound by 2 to make this like, to make sure that LHS is equal to RHS. Something over here is equal to this. Okay, so O2 gives 2 Na2O. O was only 1. There was only one oxygen. I multiplied this by 2. So now there are two oxygen, two oxygen. But come to sodium. There is only one sodium over here, and this was Na2O. So now I've also multiplied this by 2. This makes 4. So I put a 4 over here. Now this equation of mine is balanced. As much atoms are over here, they are over here as well. All right. So similarly, we have Mg plus O2 gives MgO. They both had a valency of 2, 2, so they combined to form MgO. Okay, this was plus 2. This was minus 2. Minus 2. Plus 1. Okay, so plus 2 minus 2, 2MgO. Since O2, 2O, Mg, Mg only one here, 2Mg. Again, an example. Aluminium plus 3O2 gives Al2O3. Okay, now remove this for a minute. This was adding aluminium to oxygen. All right, compound formed was aluminium oxide. Okay, this has a valency of 3. This has a valency of minus 2. What happens over here? Okay, they exchange these. Al becomes 2, this becomes 3. Okay, so since Al2O3, how many do I have here? 3. How many do I have here? 2. But I can't add an oxygen, alright? I can only multiply this by something so that it becomes a like number here. So 3 and 2, since one is odd, one is even, I know that 6 is a multiple of both. Okay, so what do I do to make oxygen 6? I multiply this by 2. What do I use to make oxygen 6? I multiply this by 3. Okay, but over here, aluminium, 2Al2, this is 4 right now. I put a 4 over here. This is balanced. Okay, so now we come to the reaction with water. Alright, so how does a metal react with water? We know how metals react with O2 right now. Okay, now that much we know. Now, how does it react with H2O? Metals always react with water to form hydrogen. Okay, they will form an hydroxide compound plus H2 will be released always with water. Now I'll show you how. Sodium reacts violently with water. Always remember this. This is an important point. This is a case. Sodium Na reacts violently with water. How violently? It is really heat, hot, really hot. Okay, reacts violently with water. Sodium plus H2O gives NaOH and H2. Alright, so this is a balanced equation. Na plus H2O gives me NaOH. NaOH is an important compound. This is to NaOH. What is NaOH? Sodium hydroxide. H2 is hydrogen gas, and sodium plus, this is sodium plus water. Always remember this equation. This will give you a lot of heat. Okay, sodium is stored generally in kerosene so that it does not react with air around it. It is a highly reactive metal. Magnesium. Magnesium reacts with water to form magnesium hydroxide. Alright, magnesium hydroxide. and hydrogen gas. Always remember, if they tell you hydrogen is removed with a metal, it is either a reaction with water or either a reaction with acid, alright? When it is reacting with water, it will always form a hydroxide, NaOH, MgOH whole twice. Why whole twice? The valency, the extra electrons that it can give to form the compound is 2, okay? So it reacts with, suppose, see, I'll show you, Mg plus 2 hydrogens, 1 oxygen, okay? So I will make a compound of MgOH whole twice, alright, plus, this was an arrow, hydrogen is removed. Now hydrogen will not be removed just like this. Now we will balance this equation, okay? 1 Mg, 1 Mg, 2H, 1O, okay? This will be multiplied by 2. Why? Because hydrogen cannot be one atom, we have to balance it. 2H, there was also 2H, but this was left, so this was making 3. Now I make this 4. Here also there are 2H, 2H, 4. This is balanced now. Alright, so always remember, so when metals will react with water, they will form hydroxides and hydrogen gas. Hydrogen gas is exerted as bubbles, alright, they will be bubbling in the test tube or wherever hydrogen is produced. Hydrogen is also used as fuels, okay? Hydrogen can be used to produce energy. Hydrogen, right now, people are trying to develop technologies so that hydrogen can be used as fuels in most of the things, hydrogen rockets and all, because hydrogen is used in rockets, alright, rockets. Due to its high heating capacity, and it does not leave any residue. What do I mean by residue? Any ash. Only it will leave water. Now, how metals react with acids? How do metals react with acids? Like I told you, H2 will always be released. Alright, water and acid, metals will give hydrogen gas. Alright. Now, metals that are more reactive than hydrogen give out hydrogen when reacted with acids. Let's go back to the reactivity series. Alright. What all metals are more reactive than hydrogen? These metals. Above hydrogen, lead, tin, iron, zinc, carbon, aluminium, magnesium, calcium, sodium, potassium. All these, when reacted with acids, will give out hydrogen. Okay, so let's go down. I reacted magnesium with hydrochloric acid. What is hydrochloric acid? Hydrogen and chlorine combined to form hydrochloric acid. Okay. Non-metal compounds are generally acidic in nature. Okay. Like metal oxides were basic. Non-metals form acidic oxides, acidic compounds and all. Okay. So copper, silver and gold will not undergo any reaction because they are below hydrogen. Okay. Although copper reacts with sulfuric acid and nitric acid, this is an exception again. Copper will react with some acids that are sulfuric and nitric. The formula are H2SO4 is sulfuric, HNO3 is nitric acid. Okay, so magnesium over here reacting with hydrochloric acid gave me magnesium chloride. Chlorine got over here. Okay, magnesium being a more reactive metal, it displaced chlorine. Okay, displaced hydrogen and took chlorine to itself. Okay, he said ki, like, I am more reactive, give me chlorine. Okay, hydrogen has no option but to give chlorine to him and get out like this. Why? Because magnesium is more reactive than hydrogen. Over here, Na, sodium is more reactive than chlorine, sorry, hydrogen, again, hydrogen, okay. So, since sodium is more reactive than hydrogen, it displaces hydrogen to form sodium chloride and hydrogen gas is released. Similarly for zinc, zinc is more reactive than hydrogen, so it displaces hydrogen, took chlorine to itself, ZnCl2. And this is H2 released. Now we come to displacement reactions. Till now you just saw a little bit of displacement reaction. I will go into depth of it now. A more reactive metal can displace a less reactive metal like we saw. A more reactive metal like magnesium was able to displace hydrogen, okay, from their salt solution. What was the salt solution earlier? HCl. Alright, so right now, when I put some reactive metal, a highly reactive metal, what was the most reactive metal? Potassium. In any other salt solution of any other metal, supposedly it was FeSO4. Potassium being more reactive will say, iron, I will take this SO4 from you. Okay, I will take this SO4 from you and you go away. Okay, so SO4 will come with potassium and Fe will go away. So Fe plus CuSO4 over here, copper is less reactive than Fe. If we go back, copper comes over here. Iron comes way over here. There is a difference. Iron is more reactive. What happened was, in a salt solution of copper, I put a highly reactive metal, that is iron. Sulfate ions, SO4, will go with Fe. Alright, will go with Fe and Cu will be left like this. Okay, consider these ions to be someone's girlfriend and this being a alpha male or a very good looking guy, he took it away. Alright, so just an example, and like this. Okay, supposedly this was a bigger ant. Consider the example of ants. Fe is a bigger ant and Cu is a smaller ant, okay, a smaller insect. It has some food. The bigger ant will say, give me that food, and go away. Just like this. Now there is some catch to it. Copper sulfate solution is blue in color. Ferrous sulfate solution is green in color. So when I add iron to this blue solution, the solution will turn green due to FeSO4 and iron will be deposited down. Okay, similarly with Mg and CuSO4, magnesium is more reactive than copper. Alright, magnesium is highly reactive and way more than copper. So it will take the sulfate ion, okay, to itself. They will form MgSO4 and Cu. Okay, similarly with zinc as well. Important chemical properties of non-metals. Okay, so with non-metals, non-metals tend to gain or share electrons to form negative ions. So they can take, gain, they can share. Alright, non-metals do not react with acids. This is a major difference between metals, non-metals. Metals react with acids. These do not. Okay. Non-metals can react with oxygen to form non-metal oxides. Okay. Consider non-metal oxide as NO2, SO2, nitrogen dioxide, CO2, and SO2. These are all oxides form with non-metals. Alright, these are acidic in nature. Metal oxides were basic in nature. Non-metal oxides are acidic in nature. Alright, remember that. Consider the reaction with oxygen. Alright, non-metals form acidic oxides. Okay, non-metals form acidic oxides. SO2, like I gave you an example, sulfur plus O2. SO2, this is written like this, SO, small 2, alright, acidic in nature. Non-metals will also react, I will give you an example of acidic oxides. Have you heard of acid rain? It is damaging the Taj Mahal, it is damaging our monuments, our buildings. What is acid rain? Due to pollution, a lot of these oxides are present in the atmosphere. In the air, when it rains, water combines with these H2O plus these acidic oxides SO2 NO2 and all to form acid. Okay, sulfuric acid, H2SO4, HNO3, like I told you. These are very corrosive in nature. They damage whatever they fall on. All right. They burn things. So this was happening that due to these acids being present in the air when it rains, our monuments were undergoing damage. How did it start? Through pollution. All right. So this is also an example of how these are acidic. Acids are corrosive in nature. They burn. All right. So reaction of non-metals in water. How does metal react in water? It gives out hydroxide and H2. All right. Now we come how do non-metals react with water? Non-metals do not react with water or steam to form hydrogen gas, unlike metals. This is because they cannot give electrons to H2 in water. Thus, H2 gas cannot be produced. All right. Since non-metals are something that gains electrons or accepts electrons or shares electrons, it doesn't have electrons to give to H2 so that it can displace it and get hydrogen as a different compound. Okay, so non-metals, they do not react with water. Reaction with acids. This is important. How does one non-metal react with an acid? Supposedly sulfur with sulfuric acid. What happened was sulfuric oxide and water was obtained. All right, so H2O will always be produced when non-metals are reacting with acids. Always H2O will be produced, and non-metal oxide. Here I reacted sulfur with sulfuric acid. What did I get? Sulfur oxide. Okay, sulfur dioxide. All right, sulfur dioxide. Like CO2 is carbon dioxide, SO2 is sulfur dioxide, and water over here, phosphorus with nitric acid. What did I get? Phosphoric acid. This is phosphoric acid. I got a non-metal oxide. This is nitrogen dioxide, and I got water. Simple. Now we go to uses of non-metals. Where are non-metals used? Okay, we went through a lot of these. Fertilizer, see this Lay's packet. Nitrogen is used as a preservative. Let me write this properly. Preservative. Okay, oxygen is used by us. Chlorine is disinfectant. Iodine. What is iodine? I. Okay, where is it used? Have you seen betadine? Have you seen the doctor applying or the nurse applying a yellowish, purplish, brownish solution to your wound when you got injured, when you got an injury in school or anywhere, and it was blood flowing, and they put this iodine. Iodine is used in solution to put on wounds. It helps you heal better. All right, it helps you heal better. Sulfur and phosphorus, where are these used? Are used in fireworks and crackers. So during Diwali, we all see phosphorus and sulfur salts a lot in the atmosphere. That is the major thing causing pollution. Okay, phosphorus. Have you seen matchsticks? Okay, matchsticks. They light up. All right, matchsticks. This is made of phosphorus. That blackish compound, right? That burns. That is phosphorus. Now we come to carbon. Where is carbon? I am made of carbon. You are made of carbon. We have a lot of carbon everywhere. This earth is carbon-based life. All right, the trees, the table, the desks, everything is made out of carbon. All right, carbon is found in everything you eat. Okay, if it is biodegradable, it has carbon, and even if it does not, there are chances there is carbon present over there. Okay, we are a carbon based life form. All right. Now, what do I mean by compounds? Okay, ionic compounds, covalent compounds, metals and non-metals together form an ionic compound. What is ionic compound? Supposedly this is a metal Na, this is a non-metal Cl. Since metals give electron, there is an electron over here, and non-metals accept electron, the bonding that is formed from giving electron and taking is what? It is ionic bonding. These are strong bonds, strong, very strong bonds. It is difficult to overcome. NaCl, okay, sodium chloride, that is salt. Okay, salt. It is very difficult to separate Na and Cl on their own. Okay, since it is ionic bonding, it requires more energy to overcome to get them separately. Okay, covalent bonding on the other hand, okay, is something different. Covalent bonding is done by sharing of electrons. Okay, I have around 10, So, carbon shares electrons, okay, formed between non-metals through sharing of electrons, carbon forming another compound with carbon itself will be a covalent compound, sharing of electrons. Okay, it will share electrons. It cannot give, one cannot take. It has a valency of 4. Okay, so 4-4. It will share to make a covalent bond, not an ionic bond. Examples of metal compounds are sodium chloride, calcium carbonate, calcium and carbonate. Okay, non-metal compounds are carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is also covalent. See, two non-metals. Okay, water is neutral. Alright. So yeah, this is what was it. And let's go for alloys again. Now we have some more names of alloys. Stainless steel, we have done. Duralumin. Okay, it is made of aluminium, copper, magnesium and manganese. Okay, all these combine to form this. This is what is generally used in airplanes. So aluminium is used, but duralumin is stronger, lighter. Alright, so it is used in aeroplanes. Brass, bronze, steel. Like I told you, steel is iron and carbon. Stainless steel is iron, chromium, nickel and other elements. Always remember this. See over here. Brass. Brass is used for music instruments. This is bronze. Bronze statue. I have application of alloys, cutlery, kitchen utensils, surgical instruments, construction materials. This is all stainless steel. I have aircrafts, automobile parts, structural components. This is all duralumin. Why? Because these are lightweight. We want our transport to be lightweight, yet I want it to be strong. Okay. So that I do not get damaged, but since it has less weight, it will use less energy. Alright, so yeah. Now, musical instruments, decorative items, plumbing fittings, this is all brass. Like I told you, this is all brass. Now we come to bronze. Earlier coins were there, bells were there, bearings, statues, Statue of Unity, it is bronze. Musical instruments, okay? All these comprise of alloys. What alloys? Bronze. Okay. So that will be enough for today. Thank you.